Hi, I'm Tim. Join me in this video as I talk about FAA Part 103 Ultralight certification procedures and how there could be some lessons learned for the radio control pilot drone community with the process followed by ultralights that we are facing now. Let's get to it. As RC and drone pilots, we are very much aware these days that the FAA is getting a lot more involved in our modeling activities. In the old days with radio control flight, the FAA pretty much left RC models alone. We were gas-powered models. We had to keep visual sight of them. There was no beyond line of sight operations. They were generally below 400 feet. And for the most part, we operated at club fields. And so we knew where we were. We would stay away from other aircraft operations, coordinate with airports. So the FAA could have a relatively hands-off approach to our modeling activities. As a matter of fact, there was a single-page advisory circular. It basically said follow the Academy of Model Aeronautics safety code, and everything worked out okay just due to the technology and the nature of our flying. This approach, this hands-off approach, started to change in the past couple of years, 10, maybe 15 years, and what caused it to change was essentially technology. What was happening was we had powerful brushless motors, we had lithium polymer batteries, and manufacturing techniques that could build drones that flew quite well right out of the box. So it was a whole generation of modelers, hobbyists that could buy a drone at the store, fly, not be part of any club system, and they had very advanced cameras on there to take pictures and do activities that were not normally envisioned by RC modelers. The problem with this, these drone flights, because they weren't connected to any regulatory oversight, were operating in the National Airspace System. They were impacting commercial aircraft operations. The FAA was taking notice, and Congress directed that something had to be done to understand the problem and regulate it to some extent such that safety was maintained in the National Airspace System. What happened with modelers, the first step really was taken about 2015, where the FAA required that we register our, they call them UAS, Unmanned Aircraft Systems. That could be a radio control model, it could be a drone, generally a unmanned aircraft under 55 pounds for the purpose of the discussion. So we had to have some sort of registration, step one. After that, in 2016, came the establishment of Part 107 of the FAA regulations regarding commercial UAS drone operations. And in the FAA website, they pretty much, instead of UAS, they use the term drone a lot, but it's all drone RC model, it's just unmanned aircraft, where you had to get a license to have any sort of commercial operations with your RC model or drone. I have this license, you have to study, it's a pretty involved test, you can't just walk in and take it, you get a certificate from the FAA, and you must have this in possession if you do anything that is a non-recreational type of RC model flying. The other thing that happened back in June of this year, June of 2021, this is being recorded in October of 2021, was the first time of a trust test. It was the recreational UAS safety test. That was the very first time ever that recreational radio control modelists, hobbyists, RC plane pilots had to take a test. It's a very easy test to take. It's online. It's correctable to 100%. And you have to have the trust certificate in your possession if any law enforcement officer at some point in time requests to see that certificate. And then the other thing that happened, that's the next big step, is remote ID. The remote ID, this is the ability for the FAA to determine where on the ground the RC model pilot is. This is a pretty big deal. We've never had to account for our location flying. This aimed mostly at drone operators that can operate literally anywhere. Industry is figuring out how to do this. It's coming out in stages. But by September of 2023, a little less than about 2 years from now, every drone sold in the U.S. will have to have remote ID. You'll have to have a portable remote ID for your RC airplane. The only exception is if you fly at an AMA field, they will almost certainly be given an exception because you're flying at the field. So what is happening to us with our RC models and model airplanes and drones? The FAA is getting involved, and I think it is useful, as I was thinking about the other day, to observe, discuss what the FAA did with a very similar set of circumstances with regulating the ultralight flying community. So as an overview, before I get into what an ultralight is and the specifics, because there is a Part 103 regulation on ultralights, the FAA is responsible for safety in the National Airspace System. They just want various people that are flying. It could be commercial aircraft, it could be passengers, it could be people flying gliders, it could be private aircraft, it could be people parachuting out of airplanes, have a series of regulations such that they can operate safely, but have the freedom to do what they want to do. I think overall the FAA does a pretty good job on this. The one thing I wanted to point out that will help you understand how the FAA approaches us with our RC modelers is the FAA makes a very large distinction between commercial operators and recreational operators. With commercial operators, the idea is like with an airline, United Airlines, you have an aircraft, there are people buying tickets on the aircraft, they just expect a safe and competent operation for the pilots, flight attendants, controllers, and mechanics. With commercial operations, in this case Part 121 of the FAA regulations, there are extreme requirements for everybody to ensure safety. When you have recreational flying, full-scale flying, flying your Cessna 150, Cessna 172, and so forth, that's under Part 91. There are regulations for that. You have to take ground testing, flight testing, recurrent flights, because the idea, even though you're flying your own airplane, you could be taking passengers. It is reasonable for the public that's flying with you expect some level of training for you to fly that aircraft. Where ultralights come in is a very different situation because there's absolutely no training, minimum FAA oversight on that, yet people are still flying in the National Airspace System. So let's go over a little bit of history of ultralights. And the ultralights, the first ultralights, were really what we would call hang gliders. And when the FAA talks about a hang glider, that is an airplane that can fly a person, but there's no landing gear. The person runs on the ground, launches himself or herself off of a cliff, and they fly, then they land back on their feet. The first hang gliders were really in 1891 with the Germans, Otto Lilienthal. There weren't any engines that could have powered flight. He did a lot of hang glider experiments. That led to research and literature that the Wright brothers built on. The Wright brothers actually did hang gliding of their designs to see how they fly, to learn how to fly. And of course, the Wright brothers would take that, add a motor, and in 1903, they have powered flight. So what has been happening was the hang gliding was developing over time to get up to the 60s with lighter materials, advanced construction techniques. They were getting pretty good at the hang gliding, but they were flying up to 10,000 feet. They were flying near airports. There was absolutely no oversight or regulation, a lot like what's happening with drones today. And then at the same time in the 1960s, people started putting motors on these hang gliders. So you have motorized hang gliders. The FAA had to get involved in the 1970s to figure out what to do, if anything, because you had people flying airplanes with motors in the National Airspace System with absolutely zero training whatsoever. So what to do? What the FAA did is very well, it's exactly what they did with our modelers. When they had the rule for remote ID that came out a few months ago, what they did was they asked for inputs from anybody that was interested. There was about 53,000 inputs. Of course, we have a thing called the internet these days. Did not have that back in the 70s. And also the FAA worked with what they call stakeholders, organizations that are involved with these. It could be the Experimental Aircraft Organization. It could be the Aircraft Owners and Pilots Association. It could be the Hang Glider Association. Or it could be the Academy of Model Aeronautics, people that represent large groups of people and can provide good information to the questions the FAA may have. So this is what happens to the ultralight. The FAA got together with these people and came up with a series of rules that made it into what the FAA called Part 107. Remember, Part 121 is United Airlines. Part 91 is you flying your Cessna. Part 107 is the commercial RC model operations. 103 is ultralight operations. So the first thing the FAA did as they wrote Part 103 is they came up with the term ultralight. Ultralight is an important term because the FAA, for all their other regulations, talks about aircraft. Aircraft is anything that flies. An aircraft could be an airplane, fixed-wing airplane, it could be a glider, it could be a hot air balloon, it could be a helicopter, it could be a gyrocopter. They're all aircraft that fly. Ultralight is not an aircraft. Ultralight is a standalone thing. And what happens is they have Part 103 for the ultralights. This is an easy internet search. And what's interesting in this entire ultralight regulation, it's 4 pages long. That's it. And what I want to do is hit some of the high points of the ultralight regulation and then finish up the video discussion with some rationale behind it. that will give useful insight to how the FAA approached the ultralight, how they're going to approach drone operations. And so I think it's a partnership. I think the FAA is doing a very good faith effort to minimize regulation where it's not needed, yet have some sort of regulation for safety. An analogy that you might use to think about this is in the United States, scuba diving, swimming underwater. There is no requirement to have a scuba diving license, certification, anything. You can get tanks from your friend, you could put it on, you can go underwater, and you can swim underwater with scuba gear. That is an extremely unwise idea because you could hurt yourself very easily. And so what the Scuba Association has is various community-based organizations, national organizations, that run certification, training, testing, because it's in our own self-interest on that. And you see with the ultralights, also the RC modelers, the FAA is surprisingly reliant on community-based organizations. In our case, the Academy of Model Aeronautics is a real advocate for us on these ongoing discussions to come up with the best outcome for modelers in general while meeting the needs of the FAA for safety of the National Airspace System. So the Part 103, it goes through a lot of things that aren't really relevant to modelers like cloud clearance requirements. But what I'd like to do is go over some of the general stuff. And the first part is the applicability of these regulations. So this is the definition of operations on ultralight in the United States. So the FAA says an ultralight is a vehicle that is intended to be used for manned operation by a single occupant, one person. You cannot take any passengers on this aircraft. It can be used for recreational or sport purposes only. You cannot run a business on it. It does not have any U.S. airworthiness certificate. When it's powered, because they have unpowered ultralights for the hang gliders, but if it's powered, it has to weigh less than 254 pounds with an empty weight. The fuel capacity cannot exceed 5 gallons. It cannot fly any faster than 55 knots at full power level flight, and its stall speed must not exceed 24 knots. When you put all these requirements together, you get a pretty carefully defined understanding of what an ultralight is. It's not going to go too high, not going to go too far, not going to go too fast. And so they can group them together. And what the FAA is doing with this approach is realizing because they're smaller aircraft, because they have these slow flight operations, they're going to fly in out-of-the-way places away from busy commercial aircraft like a Cessna, and they're going to stay low, and they're probably going to see look out for each other. The other thing that's important is single pilot operation only. The reason they don't want anybody carrying a passenger, because these are completely unregulated vehicles, the passenger could assume that the pilot is some sort of certification. The FAA doesn't want any misunderstanding, single pilot operation only. The other thing that I find fascinating, frankly, is certification and registration. And so what it says is the component parts and equipment are not required to meet airworthiness certificate requirements for an aircraft. There is no airworthiness requirement at all. There is no need for airman certification. If you operate an ultralight vehicle, you don't need to meet any test in aeronautical knowledge. There is no age requirement. There is no experience requirement. And you don't need a medical. You need literally nothing. It's like building a car in your backyard. You build it, you drive it on your property, the government's not involved. And then there's also no registration of markings on the aircraft. They're not required to be registered to bear markings of any type. And so one thing that might jump out is, well, why do I have to register my RC modeler if these ultralights don't have to be registered? Again, the reason is due to the operating characteristics of them. They stay below 400 feet, pretty close to a home airport. Drones go all over the place, high altitudes. We know they have flown over commercial airports, shutting them down. That's why they need some registration, because drones have demonstrated the operational capability to go far beyond a normal remote operating location. And some of the other rules, just for your background information, the FAA says no hazardous operations. That's pretty standard with anybody. So if there's a rule or regulation or something silly happened with a pilot, you can always be brought up with careless and reckless operation. That's why they have the hazardous operation. It'll be same for the RC modelers. The ultralights, they cannot fly at night. They have to be in daylight or twilight operations. They have to give way over right away. They can't operate over congested areas. Again, it's safety. If there's a sporting event, there's people at a football stadium, they don't want ultralights flying over there because there is no certification. There could be a catastrophic event And again, the FAA is responsible for safety. And that is really it for the regulations. Pretty simple. It's a hands-off approach, and you can quite literally design, build, and fly an airplane all by yourself with no training, no license, no medical, no FAA oversight whatsoever. That is legal in the United States. What I'd like to do now is just briefly go into a little bit of a background of this regulation. It's actually a preamble by the FAA in the Part 103 to give rationale, explanation, how and why the FAA came up with these the regulation in Part 103. And I think it gives good insight to their thinking and how we might understand this process. And again, the Part 103 was written in 1982. It's basically 40 years old. And so it's stood the test over time. It hasn't changed. I think there are some insights we can draw from this towards our modeling activities. So the one thing that the FAA had to define ultralight was a stall speed of 24 knots. The reason they came up with that, it greatly constrained the operation of the ultralight aircraft. But more importantly, from the FAA's perspective, it's very easy to calculate a stall speed just by looking at the aircraft wing, camber, various technical aspects to come up with a determination if it meets that 24 knot maximum speed. So that made sense on there. The single occupant requirement is interesting for the ultralights because a lot of commentators say we want two-person operations to train. And what they said is the whole purpose of ultralights is sport operations. If you're training people, you're making money. That's a commercial operation. You can't do that. Now, understand that there are essentially two-seat ultralights that have a registration number. They're part of an experimental aircraft, so you can get training. They're just not technically ultralights under this definition. There's a license involved to fly that. But what's interesting is this, on a single occupant. The FAA says, for example, the assumption can be made that a person who elects without pilot qualifications to operate an uncertified vehicle alone is fully aware of the risks involved. That means if you're getting in an ultralight, flying it with no training, no license, and you wind up hurting yourself, you know exactly what you're getting into. So you're given the freedom, just like a scuba diver without training, to hurt yourself if you want to do it. A passenger doesn't have that understanding. That's why they're not allowing any passengers. And they says persons in the general public will likely assume that the operator has certified pilot requirements if they fly an ultralight with a two-seat. So that's that. The recreational and sport purposes only. It just says it is recreational only. Very similar to RC modelers will give you a lot of freedom for your recreation, but not in pursuit of a business. That's a different discussion. And says, like any sport, participants are viewed as taking personal risks that do not affect others not involved in the activity. The other thing was certification and registration. And again, the FAA states right in their preamble, the intent of the FAA is to provide for safety in the national airspace with minimum amount of regulations. Accordingly, those vehicles which meet the definition of ultralight vehicle will be exempt from FAA certification and registration requirements. Similarly, pilots of ultralight vehicles, as defined in this part, 55 knots, 24 speed, weight, will not be required to possess FAA pilot certificates or AMRID medical certificates. So that's pretty remarkable that you can do something like that. The one thing I do want to point out that people that fly these ultralights, and a lot of people do, because you're not certified, they're not registered, they're not aircraft, you can't log any of this flight time for future pilot certificates. You're just doing this. It's like driving your jet ski on the lake. It's just for your own fun and recreation. And what it says is the FAA will continue to monitor performance of the ultralight community in terms of safety statistics, growth trends, and maturity, and if indicated, will take additional regulatory actions to prevent degradation of safety to the general public while allowing maximum freedom for ultralight operations. And it says, in summary, it should be emphasized that the individual ultralight operator support and compliance with national self-regulation programs is essential to the FAA's continued policy of allowing industry self-regulation in these areas. The FAA doesn't want to get involved with the ultralights, but if they see something bad happening, something going in the wrong directions, they will get involved to your detriment. I think we can take this to heart with the RC modelers. Continue discussions with the FAA. Understand, make sure they understand our concerns. The preamble continues on with the pilot certification. Again, as part of the comments in the early 1980s on this, a lot of people said you've got to have training, you've got to have exams, you've got to have check rides. all this stuff, the FAA just looked at it and they said, we're not going to do that. We just don't want to get into that oversight for this particular community, relying on the organizations with ultralights to come up with these safety rules in their own interest. Same with aircraft registration. They said there's no need to register it, again, because they fly in a fairly restricted flying zone, and there's no need for aircraft certification. The FAA doesn't come out to make sure that it meets certain strength and safety requirements. It's up to you as the individual operator. Another aspect of the FAA's preamble to Part 103 that is very instructive for flying RC models and drones is operations over congested areas. Again, we fly our models, and we've all been at the field when people crash. They may hit people on the flight line, they may hit cars, they may crash on the field. RC models crash from time to time. So there are restrictions to flying over congested areas, same with the ultralights. And so the FAA just says no operations over congested areas. And the FAA's position is based on the fact that ultralight vehicles are not certified as airworthy by any approved method and are flown by uncertificated pilots for sport purposes only. The FAA believes that concentrations of the general public must be protected from the possible dangers inherent in the operation of vehicles of uncertified, possibly unproven designs. And so that makes sense that that would apply to the drones. I think that's a reasonable thing. Also, the question came up from the ultralight operators, well, geez, you should come up with some specific regulations on how we operate these ultralights around by airports. That would make things safer. Again, the FAA looked at this, and there's just every airport's a little bit different with their terrain, weather, mountains, operations at the airport, especially uncontrolled airport. And it's interesting what the FAA came up with 40 years ago. The FAA has concluded that ultralight operations could be handled much more efficiently by airport managers, developing local procedures in concert with the ultralight community. This way, the available facilities can be used to the full extent while operational safety is maintained. Additionally, the interaction of the ultralight operators and the airport managers will serve as a mutual understanding of this growing segment aviation will play in the years ahead. And they're thinking behind that, at many of these uncontrolled airports, and uncontrolled means there's no control tower, you just look, you might talk on a unicorn frequency, but you could have Cessna operations. If it's big enough, you could have private jet aircraft. You could have gliders. You could have parachute operations. They work out local procedures how to do that. Ultralights just have to fit into that. And the best thing is just to talk to that airport manager. I'd like to thank you for viewing this video. I think there's a lot that we can gain insight from the FAA approach that we can use to our advantage as we, as a community, are negotiating, literally negotiating with the FAA for things that we want to do with our RC model airplanes, drones. When the FAA had their notice of proposed rulemaking for the remote ID and some other things, or as I mentioned before, there's about 53,000 comments. There was approximately 2 years of discussions with the various stakeholder organizations, including the AMA, to come up with a final rule. And there were a bunch of changes from the original FAA rule for modelers to what came out. The FRIA, again, is a perfect example. One thing that they wanted to do with the remote ID was have a national database. They wanted the drones to actually have connectivity with the internet wherever they flew. It was pointed out, you go into remote areas, North Dakota, this might not be possible. So the FAA listened and they responded. I think it's best to have a cooperative approach with the FAA. The FAA is responsible for the safety of the airspace system. They will not back away from that. They'll give us our freedom to do a lot of things, but we have to maintain in contact and what I'd call a professional partnership with the FAA. The community-based organizations will be the key from here on in. I think the AMA is a wonderful advocate for our interest in these discussions. And the next big thing is the remote ID requirement. I think it's September 16th of 2023. As I've mentioned in previous videos, I truly believe manufacturers will come up with lightweight, inexpensive options for this. The FAA's approach on the remote ID, just as a reminder, they're not mandating what size it should be, power, and so forth. These are the things that has to be done. If you come up with an approach, talk to us, and we'll look at it. If it meets the requirements, we'll bless it. So they're literally asking industry to come up with the best way ahead on that. So changing times, it's 2021. This is going to be the way it is for the future. And I think if we work together, understand the FAA, police ourselves, I should say police ourselves, but work within our community to follow our community-based rules and use a little bit of common sense, I think we'll still have tremendous freedom to operate our unmanned small aircraft, RC models, and drones in the National Airspace System. Thank you.